Hi everyone, thank you very much for attending my talk. During this presentation, I'm going to share some thoughts about dispositional properties in the social world. These are the topics I'm going to consider. First of all, I'm going to provide a brief introduction to powers and dispositions. After that, I'm going to consider the paper written by Tobias Anson Warburg, where he denies that there are causal powers in the social world. More specifically, he denies that deontic powers are not cannot be considered causal powers, because in literature, causal powers are typically intrinsic properties. In contrast, deontic powers are extrinsic properties. My guess is that the problem of dispositionality in the social world can be addressed and probably should be addressed in a different way. I'm going to argue that when we try to define entities, intrinsicality is much less important in the social world than in the natural one. And I'm going to show this by considering properties held by stocks and mortgages. If my guess is correct, there is no sense in posing the condition of intrinsicality when one investigates dispositionality in the social world. So one could, for example, consider McKittrick's approach on powers and dispositions, since it does not impose the condition of intrinsicality, and see if in the social world there are properties that can be said dispositional. And I'm going to consider volatility, that is the tendency of a price to change sharply and quickly, as an example of dispositional property in the social world. So first of all, what are powers and dispositions? In metaphysics, there are two types of properties, categorical properties and dispositional ones. Having a certain mass, shape, and length are examples of categorical properties. In contrast, being soluble, fragile, and conductive are examples of dispositional properties. The main difference between these two types of properties is that dispositional properties, in order to manifest themselves, needs to be placed in the right circumstances. A sugar cube manifests its solubility only under certain circumstances, such as when the sugar cube is placed in water. These circumstances allow the sugar cube to dissolve, and by dissolving itself, the sugar cube manifests its being soluble. A sugar cube is soluble because of its molecular structure. Neil Williams points out that this molecular structure can be seen as a collection of powers, of causal powers, and the powers are more basic dispositional properties. These powers allow the sugar cube to be soluble and to manifest its solubility when it's placed in the proper circumstances. An interesting challenge is to see if there are dispositional properties in the social world. Tony Lawson claims that it's perfectly reasonable to postulate the existence of causal powers in the social world. Some of these social powers are possessed by individuals such as a judge, a doctor, and a police officer. Indeed, Lawson says that each of them has a certain causal ability. The judge, for example, has the ability to pass judgment. The doctor has the ability to prescribe drugs, and so on. However, Tobias Anson Warburg questions Lawson's thesis because he points out that the supposed causal powers attributed by Lawson to the individuals are actually deontic powers. Deontic powers are extrinsic, whereas in literature, causal powers are typically considered intrinsic properties. It follows that deontic powers cannot be considered causal powers in the strict sense. In addition, Anson Warburg notes that when a doctor prescribes a drug, the doctor does not cause the prescription of a drug. It seems more correct to say that the act or prescribing is or constitutes the prescription of the drug. Therefore, Anson Valberg concludes that the application of the causal powers to the social world is highly problematic. About Anson Valberg's paper, I have two concerns. So the first one is that he considers just the ontic powers and not other type of property. The second concern is that in providing his arguments, Anson Valberg considers the main literature on dispositional properties, and according to this literature, dispositional properties are intrinsic. However, this literature deals with dispositional properties in the natural world. One may wonder if it makes sense to apply those theories as they are to the social world. Indeed, between the natural world and the social one, there are clear differences. Unlike the natural world, the social one is created by us, and most of its properties are extrinsic. Secondly, the social world is characterized by non-physical objects such as debts, obligations, rights, and by not physical properties such as matrimony bonds, being president, being an Italian citizen, and so on. Because of these differences, what applies to the natural world may not apply to the social one. According to me, this seems to be proved by the fact that since intrinsicality is much less present in the social world, it's also much less relevant in determining the nature of its entities. And a good way to see this point is to consider the difference between a real change and a mere Cambridge change. The expression Cambridge change was coined by Peter Gitch, who questions a certain definition of change, according to which a change occurs in a certain object X if a predicate P is true of X at this moment, but is not true of X at the next moment. Gitch points out that such a definition is too broad. According to this definition, both butter's melting and butter's rising in price would be changes. However, Gitch believes that only the former is an actual change. The second is a mere Cambridge change. Gitch has in mind a narrow definition of change that, according to Weberman, should be something like a certain object X actually changes if and only if X has some intrinsic property at one time, but not at another. So intrinsic properties helps us to distinguish between a real change from a mere Cambridge one. This seems to be correct when we consider physical objects, because no one would say that the nature of the butter change of the butter changes if there is a rise in its price, not even if one is considering butter as a traded good instead of a simple physical object. Let's consider now another example. Let's consider stocks. A stock is a share in the ownership of a company, and a stock may be defensive or cyclical. A stock is defensive when it tends to provide consistent returns, regardless of the market trend. And that happens because this type of stock is issued by companies that produce and or sell products that people always buy, even during a recession. Some examples of these products are not durable hygiene items, such as toothpaste and soap, utilities such as water, electricity, and gas, and so on. In contrast, a stock is said cyclical when its return is highly conditioned by the market trend. And that happens because this type of stock is issued by companies that produce and or sell products that people buy only when the economy is doing well. Some examples of these products are furniture, cars, travels, and financial products. So the property of being defensive, the property of being cyclical are extrinsic, because a stock has one of these properties in virtue of something external to the stock itself. namely people's needs. Indeed, suppose that for some strange reason, people stop needing to brush their teeth and to bath, and they start considering brushing their teeth and bathing non-necessary activities. The stocks of the companies producing this type of product would stop being defensive and would become cyclical. Since these properties are extrinsic, the change should be a mere Cambridge change. However, it doesn't seem correct because be defensive and being cyclical define the nature of a stock. And if a stock stops being defensive and becomes cyclical, it's hard to say the nature of this stock did not change. Let's consider now another example. Suppose that I have a variable rate mortgage and I decide to convert it in a fixed one. The property of being variable rate and the property of being fixed rate are obviously extrinsic properties, since someone usually attributes one of them to the mortgage from the outside. However, I wouldn't say that the change from variable rate to fixed rate is a mere Cambridge change, since I would say that this change changes the nature of the mortgage. So it seems that when a certain entity has just extrinsic properties, some of them define the nature of this entity, even though these properties are extrinsic. If so, in order to investigate this positionality, it doesn't seem to make sense to impose the condition of intrinsicality, because it seems that in the social world, some entities don't have any intrinsic properties, and some extrinsic properties play a crucial role in defining the nature of these entities. So based on that, in order to study this positionality in the social world, one could try to apply a theory that does not impose the condition of intrinsicality. Jennifer McKittrick is one of the few philosophers who proposes a theory that does not impose this condition. She claims that these positions are not necessarily intrinsic in general, not only in the social world. Now, it's obviously behind the purpose of this paper to prove or question this general thesis. Instead, what is interesting to me is to consider the marks of this positionality she lists, because among them there is no intrinsicality. And the goal is to see if in the social world there are properties having these very marks. So these are the four marks of this positionality. A disposition has a characteristic manifestation. So for example, the manifestation of solubility is dissolution. The manifestation occurs when the disposition is triggered. So for example, the manifestation of solubility is dissolution, and dissolution is triggered when the salt is placed in water. Some counterfactuals about certain dispositions, disposition are typically true. So for example, the counterfactual, if it's placed in water, then it would dissolve, is true of the salt. Finally, there may be dispositional locutions that refer to dispositions. So for example, the locution disposition to dissolve in water refers to solubility. Now, the point now is to see if in the social world there are properties that have these marks. An interesting case that I want to discuss is volatility. A stock is said volatile when its price has the tendency to change sharply and quickly. Based on the marks listed by McKittrick, one may say that volatility is a dispositional property. Indeed, volatility has a manifestation that is a sharp and quick variation in price. The manifestation that is a sharp and quick change in price is triggered by an imbalance of trade orders in one direction. For example, many people sell, but no one buys. Some counterfactuals about volatility are typically true. So, for example, the counterfactual, if many people sell but no one buys, then its price would decrease sharply, is true of a stock. Finally, there are disposition locutions that refer to volatility. So, the locution, the disposition to change sharply and quickly refer to volatility. So, since volatility seems to have all these marks, one might conclude that volatility is a disposition. However, I think it's interesting to point out that the manifestation of dispositions such as solubility and fragility lead to a qualitative change. Instead, the manifestation of volatility leads to a quantitative change. Indeed, the price can just become higher or lower. So it remains to be clarified whether this difference may question the thesis that volatility is a dispositional property. So in conclusion, I tried to share some thoughts about basically two issues. The first concerns intrinsicality. Even though intrinsicality is crucial when we study the natural world, it seems to be much less important in the social one. Accordingly, it's probably pointless to impose the condition of intrinsicality when we study dispositional properties in the social world. If so, then one may apply McKittrick's theory about dispositionality to the social world, and I showed that volatility can be an example of dispositional property. It would be interesting to keep on studying dispositionality in the social world and see if there are other properties that can be said dispositional by following McKittrick's theory. So, thank you very much for your attention. Let me know if you have questions, comments, or objections. I would be very happy to hear from you.